Hachette Audio presents the Occupy Handbook, edited by Janet Byrne, guest editor Robin Wells, narrated by Kevin Stillwell, Samantha Worthen, and Dikran Tulane.
Dedication to Zach and Daniel, who heard a lot about the contributors and whose own contributions are of another order of magnitude. Introduction. A Tale of Two Taxes. Nobody lies groaning under the yoke of inauthenticity 24 hours a day. Raoul Vanignam. One fall morning, I stood outside the Princeton Club on West 43rd Street in Manhattan. Occupy Wall Street, which I had visited several times as a sympathetic outsider, had passed its one-month anniversary, and I thought the movement might usefully be analyzed by economists and financial writers whose pieces I would commission and assemble into a book that was analytical and, this was what really interested me, prescriptive. I'd been invited to breakfast to talk about the idea with a Princeton Club member and had arrived early out of nervousness. It seemed a strange place to be discussing the book. I tried the idea out on a young doorman. He said that he took the protest seriously, found himself wondering about the methodology, but was not involved. He didn't have the time. He didn't live in Manhattan, and, besides the doorman job, he was in school. Paying for college was difficult. The protests made sense to him, he said. For one reason, they concerned what mattered to everyone: the economy. I had expected more resistance, some frank skepticism, maybe a comment to the effect that the protest struck him as frivolous. 30 minutes later, the reaction of my breakfast companion more or less echoed the doorman's. My first indication that there was a universality to the country's reaction to the issues raised by OWS. Occupy Wall Street has the rare distinction of being a protest movement that even the objects of its attack can find little fault with. According to the Spectrum Group, a consulting firm serving ultra-high net worth individuals, 61% to 68% of millionaires support raising taxes on millionaires. Although every banker I approached to participate in this book, including J.P. Morgan Chase CEO Jamie Dimon, politely declined, it was impossible not to sense that, behind the scrim, income inequality was a subject that everyone, even bankers, wanted to speak about. A single exception to the banker's silence came late in the project, when I received a phone call from Paul Volcker. I had tried to contact him for about 2 months, two-thirds of this book's entire short gestation period, through such avenues as the Atlantic Salmon Federation. An avid fly fisherman and conservationist, he is its president. Finally, I had sent a letter by snail mail to his Manhattan address. It was an unconscionably long letter, because by then the roster of contributors, which I included, was long. I put my phone number under my signature. Fielding a call from Paul Volcker might have been daunting if he had been all business. I suppose he was. But what I heard on the phone was a disarmingly friendly laugh in a low register.
"Tell me," the former chairman of the Federal Reserve said, "did you really get all these people to write something for you?"
I remembered a Reuters headline from a few months before. Paul Volcker says Volcker rule too complicated. The story was written after the collapse of the brokerage MF Global. MF's filing for bankruptcy was held up as an object lesson in the need for the so-called Volcker rule, which limits the kind of proprietary trading that helped lead to the worldwide financial collapse. Another rumble, one or two more questions. I was being vetted, but there was no hint of challenge. What I detected was more of a complicitous, "we're all in this together" sentiment. One sense that this was a man who liked the truth and knew how to find it. His piece came in immediately after, arriving on the same day as the rock guitarist Tom Verlaine's interview with gonzo Rolling Stone journalist Matt Taibbi. Paul Volcker and Matt Taibbi feel basically the same way about things. This is a book about fairness. It came together shockingly fast.
in a small laundry room in an old house in the farm belt. My office, Bucks County, Pennsylvania, was once a farm belt. With its pharmaceutical and financial corporations grafted onto a largely discarded agricultural landscape, it displays some of the same perversions of income inequality and perks of high income contagion that are common to much of the country. The median household income is $74,828. Only 4.9% live below the poverty level. Infrastructure is superb, people work hard, and there is a firm volunteer ethos and charitableness. 33 miles away is Camden, New Jersey, the poorest city per capita in the nation. Median income, $27,027, with 31% of the population below the poverty level. As the sociologists Catherine Eden and Maria Kafalis and the writer Chris Hedges have shown, Camden may tell us more about the future than we realize. Its depredations are a source of pain first, and most obviously to those who live them. But they are also a source of discomfort to those who witness them. Whether the city represents an endpoint in the national income inequality debate, or a place from which to begin a discussion, it would be difficult to find many who fail to agree that its position is untenable. Fanning out from Bucks County, in every direction, the pattern of haves and have-nots repeats itself. The train ride into New York reveals a familiar American discordance. High-end condos and junkyards, pristine converted stone farmhouses, and old linen mills with smashed windows. The line originates in Trenton, New Jersey, where the median household income is $36,601 and 24.5% live below the poverty level, as compared with an overall state average of 9.1%. One passes through Princeton, median household, $104,234, 6.5% living below the poverty level. At the other end is Newark, where I was born. Median household income, $35,659, with 25% living below the poverty level. The Occupy Handbook is divided into three parts. Part 1, How We Got Here, takes a look at events that may be considered precursors of OWS. The stories of a brakeman in 1877 who went up against the railroads, of the four men from an all-black college in North Carolina who staged the first lunch counter sit-in of the 1960s, of the out-of-work doctor whose nationwide, bizarrely personal Townsend Club movement led to the passage of Social Security. We go back three quarters of a century to the New Deal and, in Carmen M. Reinhart and Kenneth Rogoff's nutshell version of their book, This Time is Different, Eight Centuries of Financial Folly, even further. Part 2, Where We Are Now, which covers the present both in the United States and abroad, opens with a piece by the anthropologist David Graeber. The world of Madison Avenue is far from the beliefs of Graeber, a Gandhian anarchist, but it's Graeber who arguably, he says he didn't do it alone, came up with the phrase, "We are the 99%. As Bloomberg Businessweek pointed out in October 2011, during month two of the Occupy encampments that Graeber helped initiate, and 3 months after the publication of his Debt, the First 5,000 Years, another trek through centuries of our relationship with money, David Graeber likes to say that he had three goals for the year: promote his book, learn to drive, and launch a worldwide revolution. The first is going well, the second has proven challenging, and the third is looking up. Graeber's counterpart in Chile can loosely be said to be Camila Vallejo, who at 23 brought the country to a standstill. The novelist and playwright Ariel Dorfman writes about her and about his own self-imposed exile from Chile, and his piece is followed by an entirely different, more quantitative treatment of the subject. This part of the book also covers the Indignados in Spain, who before Occupy began, occupied the public squares of Madrid and other cities using as the basis for their claim that the parks could legally be slept in. a 13th century right granted to shepherds who moved, and still move, their flocks annually. Part 3 lays out actions. They range from disinvestment, on the scale of apartheid-level sanctions, see Michael Lewis's interview with himself, boycott, in which he explains his embarrassment at not having stood on a soapbox during two visits to Occupy encampments, and in which he calls for the removal, by universities and other institutions, of endowment funds from the too-big-to-fail Wall Street firms. Two proposals like Felix Salmon's and Michelle J. White.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.